साक्षात् परं ब्रह्म तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः विद दैट इंट्रोडक्शन टू द रमण गीता नाउ वी एंटर इनटू द टेक्स्ट प्रॉपर The first chapter, and the first chapter is the importance of self-abidance or the importance of upasana, and that is the title of the prathamodhyaya, the first, and it says upasana pradhanya nirupanam, the importance of upasana. Here the first verse says, you can repeat if you want to. महर्षिं रमणं नत्वा कार्तिकेयं नराकृतिं मतं तस्य प्रसन्नेन ग्रन्थेनोपनिबध्यते इट सेज महर्षिम रमणम नत्वा कार्तिकेयम नराकृतिम रमणम नत्वा महर्षिम महर्षि रमणम नत्वा आई बाउ टू रमण महर्षि एंड हु इज दिस रमण महर्षि ही इज कार्तिकेय इन द ह्यूमन फॉर्म जस्ट लाइक कृष्णा वॉज लॉर्ड नारायणा इन द ह्यूमन फॉर्म जस्ट लाइक लॉर्ड शिवा वॉज Adi Shankara in the human form. So different masters have come and they have said, or people have recognized that they are the divinity in the human form. And frankly speaking, you are also the divine in the human form. But the only problem is that we have not unfolded that divinity. People only look at you as father, mother, daughter, sister, friend, enemy, isn't it? How come we don't say that those various, we don't have that relationship like that with Ramana or with any other teacher? We see them as incarnation of, not everyone, many masters come, but very few are called Bhagwan, isn't it? Bhagwan Ramakrishna, Bhagwan Ramana Maharishi, Bhagwan Satya Sai Baba. So very few people have been named that word Bhagwan. Why? It's not that they called themselves Bhagwan. They did not call themselves Bhagwan. Who called them Bhagwan? The masses. The great sages. The other learned pandits, other realized masters present during that time. They come to this conclusion that here is a fully manifest divinity in front of us. They make that statement. So who gave the name Bhagwan to Ramana Maharishi? Ganapati Muni. And it stuck. So here, because this text is being written, brought to pen by Ganapati Muniji. So he's writing it. I bow to Ramana Maharishi. Who is he? Kartikeya in the human form. And set forth his teaching in this lucid work. When we use these words, that we must invoke the divinity from within, isn't it? When we start doing something, when we started this class, how did we start? Three Ohms and Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu. any project we begin in life, we must not begin with ego. We must begin it as an offering to the divine. You may not say offering to the divine, but the inside of your heart and mind must be showering in grace. Then the best thing comes out, and then your attention is not on the project that is to be carried out, but your attention is on the divine, by whose grace the idea of the project came in the mind, and the ability to work out the project will come in the mind, and the mind will not be stuck up in the good or the bad result, because it is focused on the divine. It is his leela. And therefore, Ganpati Muniji is seeing here that this entire composition of 300 verses are his grace alone. Otherwise, he couldn't have brought that about. In the chapter 17 and 18, Ganpati Muniji, he will sing the glory of Ramana Maharishi and his divinity, because he is so devoted to the master that he is unable to stop himself. Like Krishna Bhagwan in Bhagavad Gita, he sings his own glory. there was no one to sing glory. So Krishna sings his own glory from the absolute standpoint, because he's always established. This thought you remember. Krishna Bhagwan gave the entire Bhagavad Gita from chapter 1 to chapter 18. Could he have given it as a husband of someone, as a son of someone, as a father of someone, as a friend of someone? Or even though we are seeing that he is friend of Arjuna, but when he is narrating the verses of the Bhagavad Gita, and even otherwise, Krishna was a full manifestation of divinity. What does it mean, full manifestation of divinity? That he is without any fall, ever established in his own self, in the infinite self. His vision is that of oneness everywhere, isn't it? From that point, when he is giving, he knows the entire scheme in front of his eyes. He doesn't have to think. He doesn't have to refer. He is talking from his own direct experience. Ramana Maharishi, unlike the Vedas, what do Vedas talk about? Brahman. But have the Vedas experienced Brahman? Why? Have the scriptures realized the divinity? No. Why? Even though they are expressions of divinity, they have not realized the divinity. Why? Because they are stuck in the words. And the divinity is beyond words. Exactly the same way. That divinity is expressing as you and me and this whole creation. But why are we not able to catch the divinity? Because we are stuck. We are stuck where? In our mind. We are stuck in our body. We are stuck in birth and death. So we have to unstuck ourselves. And the only way to unstuck ourselves is by thinking of the divinity, by whose grace this untangling will happen. We cannot do it. But the only tool we have is our attention, is our choice. Where do you put your attention? That is the name of the game. So, so here it is told that that Vishnu Bhagwan came as Krishna, Shankaracharya, Shiva came as Shankaracharya, Ramanujacharya was the manifestation or incarnation of Adi Shesha, and Madhavacharya was the incarnation of Hanumanji. These are the different philosophies, Dvaita, Vishishta Dvaita and Advaita. So every, in all these philosophies is the same divine who has come as in different forms. Similarly, here it is being recognized. And did Hanumanji say that I am going to come as Ramanujacharya? Did Shiva say that I am going to come as Shankara? Did Vishnu say that I am coming as Krishna? Then people recognized him as such, isn't it? So same way, here also, people are recognizing that our Raman, great Bhagwan Raman Maharishi, is the incarnation of Skanda. Skanda is Subramanyam Swami or Kartikeya. Kartikeya is the son of Lord Shiva, the elder son of Lord Shiva, the elder brother of Ganesha. And he is full of knowledge. And that's what is being referred here. In Chandogya Upanishad, it is told that Kartikeya himself appeared as Sanat Kumaras, the four sons of Brahmaji, who are mind-born sons, that he manifested there. And as the teacher of Brahma Vidya to the great sage Narada, it is Kartikeya who gave the knowledge of the self to Narad Muni. And in this way, we see Ganpati Muniji saying that we see Bhagwan Ramana in the same role as the incarnation of Kartikeya come down on earth for a divine purpose, and that is to enlighten the masses, to share his experience of divinity, practical divinity, not theoretical divinity. Scriptures are theoretical divinity. See, there are four types of scriptures. First are the Vedas. Vedas are revealed scriptures. They are called Shruti. The divine reveals to various masters. Then comes the Smriti. They are the 36 Puranas. They are the remembered scriptures. Then third comes the historical facts. We accept historical facts as Ramayana and Mahabharata because both of them are roaming around the theme of Krishna and Rama. So the goal is not the story. The goal there is to become devoted to see the greatness of Rama and Krishna. These are the three types of scriptures. Shruti, Smriti, Itihas. Revealed scriptures, remembered scriptures, and historical. There is one more category, and that is the words of saints and sages. That is the fourth category of scriptures. Now, these words of great masters, realized masters, enlightened masters, they may reflect the knowledge given in the scriptures, or they may be totally different from the conclusions that the scriptures have come to. But they are equally valid because these masters are talking out of their direct abidance in that divinity. Because they have realized that they are the divinity. They are not talking from their head. They are not talking from some belief. They are not talking from some imagination in their mind. It could be like this, it could be like that. No, they are talking from their direct experience. Then should we listen to them or should we listen to the scriptures? Because scriptures themselves say, Yato vacho nivartante aprapya manasasaha. Truth is that, divinity is that, where the words cannot reach and which the mind cannot comprehend. So scriptures say, we cannot tell you, we can only indicate the reality, but we cannot tell you what the reality is. And the scriptures also say that we cannot tell you how a sage should or should not live. They cannot say that. Why? Scriptures are talking about the reality, and the sage is he who's living, abiding in the reality. For him, it is not a concept. It is him, in and through. So therefore, Ganpati Muni, just like us also, we have studied the scriptures, we have studied in the ashram, but it was all logic. But here, it is logic backed by experience, direct experience, not just experience, direct experience, because we are all having experience. You are having experience of me, I am having experience of you. But what is the difference between direct experience and this experience? Because it will change after some time. After, for this, for one moment you are experiencing me, next moment you will be experiencing the mic, third moment you will be experiencing the camera, fourth moment you will see the pattern on the curtain, and this way your experience will keep changing. Whereas a realized master, his experience is continuous. Without any change, he abides in that direct experience. So Ganpati Muni, he has studied the scriptures, he is very well versed in scriptures. And this is the misery of many, many pandits, shastris, who are, or priests also, who chant the name of the Lord in the temple for day in and day out, but Lord is far away from them. They have not, very few priests have realized God, isn't it? They are lost in karmakand. They are lost in collecting money. They are lost in the statue. And it becomes a profession for them. It is not a, it could, if they made the choice, with this continuous interaction with the statue, with the divinity in the statue, if their approach is right, they can very quickly realize. See, one lady came. She says, "Swamiji, I am starting to do puja. Can you, I want blessings." I said, "Do puja." She is a priest from a family. I said, "Okay, good, teach, do the priest, because society needs people. And I got no problem, man or woman, it doesn't matter." I said, "Good, don't do it for money. Do it for whoever gives you dakshina, that is good. But do it as a sadhana. Look at it as an opportunity to interact with the divine and then do the puja. And if it stops in between, if it is not complete, doesn't matter. You be true to it." And over 3-4 years now she is doing it. She is unfolding like amazing. Because what language she was using 3 years ago and what questions she asks me now is world apart, because unfoldment is taking place. See, this is the difference between direct experience and experience. Otherwise it will become a profession for her also. Then I have to be busy more. We are also busy. I don't need to take 8 classes over 2 days. I could just take 4 classes. Isn't it? But we take it as an opportunity to interact with ourselves, to be available to ourselves while I'm talking. You should also take that opportunity to be with yourself as you are listening. Don't collect data. See? So the point that I was making, many people are having lot of knowledge because they studied the scriptures. But very few people are having direct experience of what the scriptures are indicating. And this was the frustration of Ganpati Muni. See, now there are, you in your, in our society also you'll see people go, they go to different ashrams, they go for different courses, 2 weeks course, 6 weeks course, they study one Bhagavad Gita or some Yoga Sutra a little bit, they understand a little bit, and immediately they want to become a teacher. And they start classes. Then I will teach. Why? It's not because they want to do sadhana. They are teaching because they want to be recognized as a guru. They want name and fame. They want to run an organization. They want to collect funds. So all that has become a means. And you will see it happening everywhere. So what is the difference between a person who has studied for 6 weeks or 2 months and then teaching, and the one who has meditated for 20 years and studied the involved with scriptures for 20 years and teaching? Maybe the other one who is speaking after 6 weeks is a better speaker. But what is the difference?
Experience
the behind. Like when I was in Varanasi, there was one person who was doing a PhD on pranayam. And he's asking me. And one day I just asked him. I said, I was doing a little bit of pranayam. I'm not adept at it. So he says, this. I said, let me read what you're writing. And some things that he had written is just. You said it, I didn't. She always falls for it.
No, Swamiji, the Lord said through me.
Okay. So I said, tell me, have you practiced pranayam? He has never practiced pranayam and he is doing PhD on pranayam. What does he know? Who is better adept at explaining? The one who has written a PhD on chocolate or the one who has tasted chocolate? Tasted chocolate. Then he doesn't need books. Then if at all he reads the books about how to make the chocolate, it will be for extra knowledge so that he can communicate. But when he has tasted the chocolate, then it will come out as an inspiration. He will be so fired up because of the joy that he has direct experience that he has had of the chocolate, isn't it? Such is our Ramana Maharishi. And all those who study the scriptures, only without being subjective about what is told in the scriptures, then it becomes a mental diarrhea, intellectual diarrhea, intellectual logic. This, oh, but it was written there like this, and it was written here like this, and this, and it. If you are not subjective, you will be lost only in comparisons. How this Upanishad is totally opposite to that Upanishad. The methodology. How that master said this, and how this master said this, and how, but what is this going on? I'm so confused. I think I don't want to follow any master. Good. Why this conundrum comes about? Because we are not subjective. Till you have not tasted the chocolate, what chocolate could be, what could the taste be, is open to discussion, isn't it? 100 people come, 100 different answers about what the chocolate is. But you give chocolate to every 100 one of them and they are tasted, after that will they speak? They put the chocolate in their mouth. The other, all 100 will do, no language required. That is the language of Ramana Maharishi, silence. So this frustration of not knowing the self, even though intellectually understanding everything about it, has brought Ganpati Muni to Ramana Maharishi. And therefore, and he got his answers, and he had the experience, like many others. And that gratitude, that grace which flowed to him, that gratitude that he is feeling towards his teacher, is being expressed in this verse. Maharshim Ramanam Natva Kartikeyam Narakrutim Matam Tasya Prasannena Granthe Nopanibadhyate. Then he says, continuing in the second verse, Ishaputra Shake Rama Bhuminanda Dharamite Ekona Trinsha Divase Dwadashe Masi Sitale. In the year 1913 of the Christian era, on the 29th of cold December, when all the disciples were seated around the attentive mind, with attentive minds, I asked Bhagwan Maharishi for definite answers to certain questions. whenever we are with masters, you should not ask how much money should I bring. Huh? It's like someone called me the other day. This example came, but I'm telling again. And he said, Swamiji, my father passed away. I said, my condolences. I don't know who this person is. He found my numbers from someone, must have given him. He said, can you do some satsang? I said, of course, tell me when and I will come. What will you talk about? Menaka, what do you mean by what will I talk about? You can't plan from beforehand what I will talk about. Something which will help everyone there. He says, they say when the soul, when the person dies, the soul hangs around for 13 days. That the satsang should be for its liberation. I said, yeah, some people believe that way, and that is right or wrong, but let's not go into it. But yes, that is the belief. And satsang should be done so that, but how does it happen? I said, you will not know. You have to die first, then you will find out. How does the soul hang around? How do I tell you? You die. So I spoke to him like that. I was in a jolly mood. And then he says, I said, more than the soul, the satsang is for the living people to teach them how to die. He says, oh, this is the way. It is not for the soul who has died. I said, yes, for him also, but more than that, to all those who have collected there and who are living. He says, acha, very good, I'll call back. And he never called back. He got scared. People read the Padma Puran. Padma Puran, no. What is that? Garuda Puran. They read Garuda Puran after the person has died. They should read it when they are alive, so that you know how to die, how to prepare for death, so that death doesn't become a journey of fear. It doesn't become a journey of burden. The death doesn't happen as a result of with attachments which have not been resolved. This is what is taught. But in that whole book, their attention goes, my God, Swamiji, they have explained the 33 or 36 different hells so explicitly, I don't want to read that. If you have committed this sin, you will be fried like a pakoda in the hot oils, alive, and you can't die. And you can't die. If you have committed this particular mistake, then they will... the vultures will come and you can't die, because in hell also you cannot die. So vultures will come, and while you are experiencing the pain, they will keep notching away your skin and your bones, and they will eat everything that you think you are. Oh my God. it's not for the faint-hearted. So you want to prepare? You prepare. So here, these students who have come in the year of 1913, on 29th of December, they are all prepared. They are not come. Where are they? I told you before, they are in the Virupaksha cave and the Skanda Ashram cave. There are two caves on the Arunachala. I'm going there. I'll be there on 23rd, 24th, 25th with few of you. And how have they come? Our problem yesterday was what? Someone told me, AC is not working. In the cave, where is the heater? So what have they come with? A single pointed purpose, that we want answers to our questions. We know all the sadhanas, we know all the scriptures, we have assessed our life, but we are still frustrated. We are still feeling incomplete. We are still identified with our body and mind, and we want conclusive answers. That there, because in the scriptures so many sadhanas are given, which one to practice? They are not able to, like milk is so much, but what is the essence of the milk? Butter. But it has to go through the process. First it must become yogurt. Then from the yogurt you will take out the butter, isn't it? By churning. You can't straight away. I can't see butter in the milk. You can never see. I can't see butter, or I can't see the divinity in this world and in myself. You can never see. First you have to churn. First you have to, like when you make yogurt, what do? With yogurt? You put a culture and you let the warm milk sit overnight. So you put the culture, I am the divinity, and sit overnight without moving. If you move the pot of milk, what will happen? Yogurt will not set. Isn't it? It has to be absolutely still. Similarly, you have to be absolutely still. And then what happens? Next day you get the yogurt. And then the churning begins. And you extract the butter from that. Same thing with us. You want to extract the butter without having settled your mind. How is it possible? And what is the butter in us? The self, the divinity, the grace. And therefore, Ramana Maharishi, here these students, they have come with the preparation. They are not complaining about the weather. They are not complaining about the food. They are not complaining about, oh, it is inauspicious to not take bath and then ask these holy questions. Forget it. Like one person I know, she tells, Mom, wash your hands before eating food. She says, my child, I have not gone out anywhere. I'm in the home only. I was watching TV, now you are asking me to. She's 87 years old. Takes so much time. By the time she gets up and goes to the bathroom and wash, she's already exhausted. And I was in their house. I said, she's right. There's nothing for her to wash. Why don't you bring a wet napkin and give it to her? Why you have to make? No. Is it right not to wash hands? Our culture says we must wash hands before food and after food. I said, then you to bring the bowl of water or you bring a napkin. Why you are making her go? So we insist on others. This insistence is not good. Get out of all this. Reality has got nothing to do with these norms of life, has got nothing whatsoever. So these Mahatmas, these eight Mahatmas who have come together at the feet of Ramana Maharishi, they have sorted their mind out to a large extent. They know what to go after and what not to go after. We have come here. Are you distracted by the motorcycle sound that went by just now? You know it is there, but did you get disturbed? No. Now the bus is going. Are you disturbed by that sound? No. If there is lightning, you will know that it is there, but you are not disturbed by the thunder and lightning. Here also, even though you are listening, your attention is on so many people. Every now and then, you may shift your attention there. Or from the corner of the eye, you will see someone moving their hand, someone scratching their head, someone changing their position. But having seen that, does it disturb you from your focus? No. Like that, these students have come together. They have sorted themselves out. They have left everything outside that cave. Even though the whole world is there, but they have come prepared that enough is enough. You had a choice to stay at home and watch cricket today, isn't it? But third day, fourth day?
Second day.
See, he knows. Second day.
No, third day.
So it could be a easy, now yaar, tennis is going on, cricket is going on. Why spend 2 days listening to, this self? Very easy for an unprepared mind. But the one who is hungry to know once and for all, because he has worked out how many more times every year I can watch the match, but I am still the same frustrated fellow. It's not going to change me. So you have sorted something out in your life, that's why you are here. Similarly, they have sorted something out. They have collected their senses. They have collected their mind. They have become focused. They are doing the tapasya, the austerity of not getting disturbed by the elements. Why their focus is only one, and that is the feet of Ramana, and a complete abandoned faith that he can give us the answers. See, just thinking about it feels so good, isn't it? Imagine when you get it, what happens? Amazing. So he says here, so he has dated the conversations, visualizing the importance of his work for all times. The expression conclusions instead of answers has been used because the Maharshi replies based on steady self-abidance would, and it is authoritative. Scriptures talk about as answers, whereas Ramana Maharshi is talking about conclusions because it is his direct experience. Scriptures do not have direct experience. They are concepts. Third verse. Upavishteshu sarveshu shishyeshu niyatatmasu bhagavantam rishim soham apruchham nirnayaptaye. He says in the third verse, when all the disciples were seated around with attentive minds, I asked Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi for definite answers to certain questions. This is upavishteshu sarveshu. Upavisht means to sit down. Sarveshu, all of us. Shishyeshu, all the students. All of us students. Niyatatmasu means self-controlled and calm, cool and collected. Where did we sit down? Bhagavantam Rishim Soham. At the feet of Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi. And who is he? He who sees everything as I. Bhagavatam Rishim Soham, Rishi. He is a Rishi. Who is a Rishi? Who is abiding in the self? And how is he abiding in the self? Soham, soham. That he is experiencing wherever he looks. Whatever he sees, hears, touches, feels, tastes, thinks, imagines, whatever. He only has the experience of I. Soham, soham, soham. I am that. This is, he is abiding in. From such a person, they are asking this question. And therefore, it is based on, it is not a, answer is not a conjecture, it is authoritative because he is abiding in it. In the fourth verse, this is the first question. Now these are the six questions that will be asked, and the Ramana Maharshi gives the answer, and this is the first chapter then. What is the first question? Satya satya vivekena muchyate kevalena kim utaho bandhanaya vidyate sadhanantaram. He says the first one, satya asatya vivekena, by the discrimination of real and unreal. Satya means real, truth. Asatya means unreal, untruth. By discrimination between the truth and the untruth, muchyate kevalena kim, Is liberation attained by mere discrimination of the real and the unreal? This is his question. Or are there other means for the removal of bondage? Scriptures, in the end, they talk about the ultimate way is discrimination. Discrimination is not, should I use basmati rice or should I use sona masuri? Discrimination is not, should I eat Indian food or Chinese food? Discrimination is not that you are a man and she is a woman. This is not discrimination. What is discrimination? Discrimination, the word discrimination is applied only when you are contemplating on what is permanent and what is impermanent, what is real and what is unreal, what is truth and what is untruth. Then only when you are thinking in this manner, it is called discrimination. And this is correct thinking. Thinking about anything in this world, it is not called intelligence. It is not called thinking. It is called worrying, according to Bhagavad Gita. Only when you are thinking about the truth in contrast to the untruth, then you are discriminating. And it is done subjectively. It is not done in your intellect that, oh, the truth is unchanging and the untruth is changing. Now I know. What do you know? That truth is changing, not changing, and untruth is changing. But what about, what is this unchanging truth? I don't know. Gone. So that unchanging truth, you have to experience directly, subjectively. So here, the teacher, student is asking that what is the best method for liberation? Is it discrimination between the real and the unreal? Or are there other methods by which we can come to the conclusion? We are all caught up in the cycle of karma. What is the cycle of karma? Cycle of karma is every act gives a result, and you keep performing the actions, it will keep giving the results, and those results become the cause of your future births, because the desire is there for more and more and more. And in this way, how do I become free from all this? That is what you are trying. Whether you like it or not, throughout the day, every day, your ultimate destination is to be free from all karma. Karma means activity, action. And are you not, is that not your destination? What do you do whole day, busy, 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 busy? Only to become unbusy. Only to go to sleep. So what is your destination every morning when you get up? Only to go to sleep. No, not busy, busy. Only to go to sleep. And why do you go to sleep? Because you get tired of being active. Physically you get tired of being active, mentally you get tired of thinking, that is also activity. So activity is at three levels, manasa, vacha, kaya. So activity is at the body level, that makes you tired. Activity is at the speech level, that also makes you tired, more than physical activity. And even more than speech, activity is at the mental level, which makes you exhausted. So we have to become free of activity. I want freedom from all this. The thoughts are persecuting me. So this freedom from activity we are seeking. And this activity is leading to birth, death, and it is without a break. It is not birth and death from this life to next life. The childhood died for the teenage to be born. Teenage died for the youth to be born. Youth died for the middle age to be born. Middle age died for the diseased to be born. And eventually death. Living person dies for death to be born. This journey. And this is not only your span of life. Now come here. Every thought is dying so that the next thought can be born. Every word is being born out of my mouth only to allow the next word to be born out of my mouth. Isn't it? Same thing at the body level. At this moment, this hand is acting. Next moment, this has to go for this something else to happen. So all activity is keeping us in the loop. There is birth and death. That is the norm of the activity. And I want to be free of it. And in this way, utaho bandhanaya vidyate sadhanantaram. Then he says, see, now, is activity good or bad? I'm asking a question. Is activity or action good or bad? Man, you guys are smart. The actions are neither good nor bad. Then what is bad or good? Huh? No, that she went wrong.
Attachment or no attachment
is also. Tell me. Yes. Yes, your attitude towards the action, your intention behind the action, activity, makes it good or bad. If you are drinking water, this is an activity. It's not good, it's not bad. But if you start thinking, without water I cannot survive. Oh my God, I am feeling so thirsty, I am feeling famine. Oh my God, I think my throat is becoming dry. And suppose water is not available. It will become a big problem. You will be uncomfortable. And yet, if you think, it's only thinking, yet if your attitude is, no, I don't want to disturb my poise when the class is going on. I don't want to drink. Can't I sit for 10 minutes without drinking water? When my child was born, I could live for 1-2 hours without drink and food because my attention was on the child. But in satsang, for half an hour, I cannot sit without even moving, without some people keep their cups of tea and coffee. Oh, it's so hot. Then truth is not for you. I'm not taking you as an example, but it is a lesson. You can't stay away from drinking water for 1 hour. How you're going to stay away from the thoughts to know the reality then? This is how we sabotage ourselves. So here he says, so activity when done unintelligently, it leaves a result. It precipitates some memory. According to the laws of the nature. And the effort of all spiritual seekers is to be free from this bondage of coming and going, free from the bondage of attachment, free from the bondage of activity. Because we feel, if I don't drink water, who else will drink water for me? If he drinks the water, my thirst will not get quenched. This is, if I don't do activity, if I don't take care of my children, who will take care of my children? If I don't eat food with my hand and put it in my mouth, who else will, if someone else eats, will I get satisfied? That is the feeling, isn't it? This is the wrong attitude which we are having. Masters think differently. If they say, see you eating, they are full. Mother also has that feeling. That if the child eats, mother feels satisfied, isn't it? She has not eaten food, but she feels satisfied. See the people, yesterday only I went to someone's house and she cooked food, so much variety. And I said, you're not eating? No, Swamiji, just looking at food and cooking for you people, I am happy. I am not very hungry. What happened there? You cooked so much with love and you're not eating? Because her happiness is when other people eat. Mahatmas are even one step further. if you eat, they sincerely, genuinely feel satisfied, like Shirdi Sai Baba. So we want to be free, and when we see that this whole world, when we say that the world, the discrimination between the consciousness and matter, the discrimination between the real and the unreal, these are different words, discrimination between the truth and the untruth. So where is our attention? If your attention is on the untruth, if your attention is on the creation, if your attention is on the jada vastu, what is jada vastu? What is inert matter? Definition? Inert is opposite to conscious, isn't it? Be very alert now, attentive. Inertness is opposite to consciousness. So what is inertness equal to?
Anything other than consciousness.
That's what I said. I'm asking a question. What is the difference between the two? Consciousness never changes, inertness keeps changing. You may not see that, I can see the carpet, it's there, it's permanent, but it's deteriorating every moment. Consciousness never deteriorates, it's ever the same. So what is inertness? What is untruth? What is unreal? That which is changing. Okay, now be very careful. Now what is changing? What is the world equal to? Equal to your world of one day is waking plus dream plus deep sleep. These three also keep changing, and within the waking and dream also everything keeps changing, isn't it? Right or wrong? Understood till here? Now, that is your world. Where do you know this world? In your mind. How do you know this world? By way of thoughts. Do thoughts keep changing? So mind is also changing. Thoughts are also changing. So it is unreal. So world is changing. Body is changing, breath is changing, emotions are changing, thoughts are changing, and what is not changing?
Your ability to see that they are changing.
The one who knows that all changes are taking place. Now, here the teacher's student's question is, see, very quickly you came to this conclusion, agree?
Yes.
It was logical. Now he says, because he has also studied scriptures. He says, if I focus on the world, that this world is changing, and I discard the world through discrimination, then how come I will be established in the truth? This is his question. We will not answer now. We will answer, see what Ramana Maharishi says. But understand the question. He says, if I focus on the discrimination, the truth is unchanging and the world is changing. If I focus on the changing and do the various practices to and discriminate, this is changing, I am not that. This is changing, I am not that. This is changing, I am not. Just like I took you through. So was the conclusion realization? It should be, no? You just worked it out. You just worked it out. That mind is changing, emotions are changing, breath is changing, body is changing, waking, dream and deep sleep is changing. You already worked out the whole world that it is changing. Then why are you not realized?
Work it out with your mind.
True.
That's why.
That's right. See? So just intellectual conviction about this is not enough. Abidance is required. I'll not answer this question. Understand the question. That's it. Scriptures say that everything is Brahman. Sarvam khalvidam Brahma. other than Brahman nothing is. If that is the case, then why do I need to discriminate between real and unreal? Then real is also real and unreal is also real. You have to be alert what I am taking you through now. So real is also real and unreal is also real. Then where does that leave me? No answers. Just listen. Enjoy the intellectual gymnastic. But we have never thought these questions in this manner. Therefore, we are still in the loop of birth and death. We are still in the loop of giving importance to the world. Because we have never thought about this in this manner. The only way, the one and the only way, excuse me, not the only way, I'm not answering. Let Ramana Maharishi answer. The questioner is asking, if everything is Brahman, the reality, then who is this fellow who is experiencing the bondage? And who is the person who wants freedom? Who is it?
Mind.
No, don't answer. Keep your answers to yourself. Is it mind? Is it ego? Okay, now you have said it, so I'm taking it further. Is it the mind? Is it the ego? But we just said mind is other than reality because it is changing. But then scriptures say everything is Brahman. So mind should also be Brahman. Thought should also be Brahman. Emotions should also be Brahman. Anger, greed, jealousy, kama, krodha, lobha, moha, mada, matsarya, that should also be Brahman. This whole changing world that we see in front of us, waking, dream and deep sleep, that should also be Brahman. Technically, if everything is Brahman, then why am I not experiencing Brahman when I interact with the world, when I am out there? Why do I have to discriminate that this is the reality and that is not reality? This is real and that is unreal. This is permanent and that is, the world is impermanent. I am the changeless, the reality is changeless and the world is changing. Why I have to discriminate between this? And why am I not able to, if everything is reality, where am I going wrong? Is only discrimination the way, or are there other ways to come and sort this out once and for all? Yeah, there is one. Sleep continuously. But that is not what we are looking for. That's the first question. Now the second one. So, for whom is the liberation and for whom is the bondage? That was the first question. Second question now. Dvitiya prashnaha. Kimalam shastra charchaiva, kimalam shastra charchaiva, jignyasunam vimuktaye, yatha guru padesham kim, upasanam apekshate. In the fifth verse he says, is the study of scriptures enough by itself to liberate those desirous of knowledge, or is the spiritual practice according to the master's injunctions also necessary? Can you liberate only by studying the scriptures? Only by intellectual conviction can you liberate, or do you need a practice behind? And what is the practice? To study more scriptures. We study the scriptures and we are saying we want to do some practice. But what is the practice? To give more lectures and study more scriptures. This is the question. In the... So he says here, so is knowledge alone the means for the release, and does that knowledge arise only through inquiry? Or do we need something else apart from the scriptures? Please tell us. This is the second question. Now he asks the third question. And if practice has to be done, would that practice be enough to release us? Suppose we are not just studying, we are practicing also. Will that practice release us? So one thing is study of scriptures. The other is some exercise, some practice. What practice we will see afterwards. Will it be able to release us? So that brings us to the third question. Sthita prajna sthiti prajnam. स्थितप्रज्ञं आत्मानं किं समर्थयेत् आत्मानं किं समर्थयेत् विदित्वा परिपूर्णत्वं ज्ञानस्योपरतेरुत इन द थर्ड क्वेश्चन ही सेज नेचुरली हाउ डज स्थितप्रज्ञा means the one who is established in the self. The word is very technical. Sthita, established, grounded, rooted. Prajna, in the direct experience of the self. How does a person who is rooted in the direct experience of the self recognize himself as such? Can a realized person say, I am realized? Don't answer. Yes and no, yes. So here, because it's a question. How does a realized person recognize himself as such? Is it by knowing the fullness of his enlightenment, or is it by cessation of objective awareness? Does he recognize himself by is it by knowing the fullness of his enlightenment? Does he? If you go to sleep, I'm asking you, telling you now. If you go to sleep every night, you are thinking of sleep, isn't it? But when you abide in sleep, do you know you are sleeping? You do not know. So, see, only after waking up you know you are sleeping. Now, unlike that, you are going into meditation. You are going into, you're seeking liberation. How do you come to know that you have liberated? Because I can go have an experience like sleep, but from sleep I'm going to wake up and then I can make a comment about it. But when I get liberated, then I do not wake up to anything. I'm always there. Then what statement will I make? And who will make? Then how does a realized master come to know that he is realized? Question to be pondered upon. Very fascinating questions. If you are with me right this moment. So,
you are in it and you are not in it. You are part of it and you are not part of it.
See, you are in the sleep. But when you wake up, are you in the sleep? No. So you can make a statement that you had a good sleep. Isn't it?
Yeah.
Is it like that? That you come to realize in sleep also no thoughts in the mind? In realization also, or meditation also, no thoughts in the mind. then who comes to know? Is it that the master says I am realized, or is the realization of a master, of a person, is by the people who are looking at him? They declare he is a realized master, because that's the question here. They say he is realized, or the master himself says that he is realized?
It will be the people who know that he is being part of us, yet he is not being part of us. He is not affected by the masses or the people around him.
But the masses themselves are ignorant.
But it's more subjective.
But how? Yes. So all these people who are declaring he is a great master, have they realized the self? No. So how can they say he has realized the self? Keep the question. Keep the question, because we are only looking at the questions here. We are not answering them. So does the realization, status of realization bestowed on the master by the people or by the master himself?
More subjective, isn't it, than that? Isn't it asking the question, a person who is realized, do they realize their enlightenment, right? Or is it their experience of the cessation of
both? Yeah, that also is, you can put.
Okay.
That also you can put. No. Is it the cessation of
objective awareness?
Of objective awareness.
Yes.
So what is it? What is it? If mind is absorbed in the self, that is realization, then who is saying that I am realized? Who is saying? If everything is Brahman, everything is reality, after that absorption, after the seeker merges into the reality, then who says that I am realized?
One who knows.
But how can he say now he has got no mind?
Or one who knows does not speak.
Yes. We are just looking at the question at the moment. You can say, yes, what you are saying is right. The one who knows, but how does he know? By thought? Then how does he know? Direct experience, yes, direct experience. Now these are questions, you make them subjective. That is this mistake I am also doing in my thinking? Am I looking for an experience? Am I looking for a result? When I say I want to liberate, I want to become one with God, I want to meditate, am I looking for do I have an idea what meditation means and that I am pursuing? Do I have an idea of realization, that realized people are always hugging and always pleasant and always beautiful, they have got sweet sounding voice and their eyes are all loving, and when you look at them you melt? Is this the type of image or idea you are carrying in your head about a realized master? Then I'll show you enough of them who will beat the every bone out of your body, and they are realized masters. They'll throw stones at you, they will abuse the hell out of you, but they are realized masters. They are masters who smoke. Oh, you have got idea that masters don't smoke, because you are living in Australia where smoking is injurious to health. But he smokes, one after the other. And what, when you see him, what will go through your mind? I think he's a kaccha realized master. I don't think he's realized. He doesn't look, he looks so angry. How can an angry person be realized? There's no beauty in his face. His speech is so dirty. I think he's judging and he's got biasness, and how can such a person be realized? And look how he is beating this fellow, how he is abusing that fellow, how he is making them both fight. I think this is not a sign of a realized master. Yeah? So your idea of realized master may be limited. Maybe. Because realized master is not of one type. Every light is, as a principle, is one, but its expressions are many. Realization is one, but its expressions are many. Now the question is, if expression are also that reality, that's where we are getting to. If expressions are, where are expressions from? From the mind or in the world? If that is also pervaded by the reality, that is also Brahman, one without a second, then who comes to know that he is realized? Is it that a realized person grows a Pinocchio nose and then we realize, oh, this is a realized person? Is it that he grows horns, then we realize, oh, he is a realized person? Is it that he does siddhis, so we realize, oh, this is a realized person? Is it that he manifests in different places and we say, oh, I think he is a realized person? Normally, this is the mistake we do, isn't it? Where we see phenomena, where we see magic, where we see some untowards experience which we have not experienced, such people we give a status of realization, realized master, because they have some siddhis. And we are in awe. Oh my God, he knows my past. He knows my future. Oh my God, he told me that this is going to happen and that's exactly what happened. Then we go to psychics. We go to these masters. And like this they do, and they give you something, and you feel blessed. Oh, he manifested, he gave me darshan of the God. We are hoodwinking ourselves. Is that what is realization? Because then your attention is not on that permanent principle, your attention is on the phenomena. Then how do we come to know? That is the question here. Fourth question, the first line is the fourth question. Jnaninam kena lingena, jnaninam kena lingena, jnatum shakshanti kovidaha, jnatum shakshanti kovidaha. In the fourth question he asks, which verse is it? Seventh. Number seven. By what indications are the learned able to recognize a realized master? So naturally, first question was, previous question was, who declares a realized person as realized? Is it the realized person who is declaring himself as realized, or is it the people who are declaring him as realized? And if both are coming to a knot, realized person doesn't need to declare he's realized, and people cannot declare because they don't know what realization is. So how can they declare he's realized? So automatically the next question comes, that by what indicators can we are the learned? Who are these learned people? Those who understand, those who are totally committed to the reality, to enlightenment. How are they able to, just by looking at the face, looking at the powers of the person, you come to declare he is a realized person? Or are there some other indicators that this person is abiding in the self? This is the next question. See, in the previous one, when do we say sthita prajna means the one who is established in the self steadily? When is he established in the self steadily? When the onslaught of thoughts is not disturbing him, isn't it? That is what we'll say. Now, if there are no thoughts disturbing and he is established, this is the previous question I'm talking about, and he is established and there is no medium of thoughts, then how does he know that he is realized? Because we know anything only by way of our mind, isn't it? Right or not? So how does he come to know? And if he does come to know, or if he is saying it or not saying it, what are the next question is, what are the indicators of such a person who is established in the state of realization, state of abidance in the self or the Atman? And in this way, this was the fourth question. Now we come to the fifth one. Jnanayaiva samadhi kim, jnanayaiva samadhi kim, kamayapyuta kalpate, kamayapyuta kalpate. Fifth question is, does samadhi lead to jnana, that is knowledge, or does it also confer the material food desired? He is saying in the fifth question, does samadhi, the conscious absorption of the mind, what is sleep? Unconscious absorption of the mind. Absorption of the mind into its source with ignorance is called sleep. Understand? And what is samadhi? Consciously you are aware that the mind has got absorbed into its source. That is samadhi. So the question here is, does samadhi, the conscious absorption of the mind in the heart, result only in knowledge, or does it also fulfill desires? Meaning that when a person, when before abiding in samadhi, what was the desire in the person's mind, in the seeker's mind? That I want to liberate, I want to go into samadhi. This is the question. I want to get into samadhi. Now the question is, once he gets into samadhi, let me go back one step. He wants to liberate. This is his desire. Are there other desires in his mind? There are, isn't it? So, if he goes into samadhi and he has come to abide in the self, will his desires, which were lurking in his mind, unexpressed? Sometimes they express, sometimes they don't, but he was focused on the self and consciously he came to abide. Will the other desires which are in his mind still, will they get fulfilled or not? That is the question. Don't get scared. Will they get fulfilled or not? That is the question. You may not have thought about all these questions.
Those desires are already abandoned.
Abandoned where?
So.
Huh?
So.
No, where?
No more desire.
Oh, but that person gets up and says, I am hungry, give me food. He comes out of samadhi and says, I am hungry, give me food. If he was in samadhi and he abided in the self, if the desires were abandoned, then he should not feel hungry when he comes out.
So samadhi is temporary.
Good. Samadhi is temporary. But he is going there. So this is what we are making distinction between is that, is samadhi the goal that we have to pursue? Is it self-knowledge is the goal that we have to pursue? Is it the direct experience that we have to pursue? Or, and after that, when the mind again comes back into play, for whom? Is it for the realized master that the mind comes into play? Or other people are saying, oh, he's still thinking. I think he's not realized. How will you come to know? And if he has come to abide in the self, then coming to know the self is equal to complete contentment, complete fulfillment, isn't it? That should be the, that is what we, our logic says. But then he comes out of samadhi and he is hungry again. He is thirsty again. He is tired. Those are also desires. That I am so exhausted, or I am so hungry. How long was I there? Question to be pondered upon. So here the teacher is, the student, he is saying that what type of samadhi are we looking for? What type of samadhi? Two ways you can get into samadhi. We'll talk about the second one afterwards. Ramana Maharishi will answer. We'll look at the first one. Nirvikalpa samadhi we are talking about. If our attention is on the world, and we are saying, I am not the world, I am not the body, I am not the breath, I am not the mind, I am not the thoughts. They are discard, 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 discard. Eventually everything is discarded. You do not get attached to anything. And the mind becomes zero. And you are conscious. This is called Nirvikalpa Samadhi. It will not lead to liberation. Why? Why it will not lead to liberation? Because your attention was on deleting everything. It was not merging yourself into the goal of reality, of the consciousness. The focus was the world. I am not the world, I am not the body, I am not the mind, I am not the intellect, I am not the thoughts, I am not the concepts. They are all changing, they are all changing, they are all changing. I don't know what real is, because I'm still in the mind, isn't it? I'm still in the mind, I don't know what real is. All I can do is keep deleting everything that is unreal and not give it value. And as I don't give it value, it keeps dissolving, it keeps dissolving. Eventually what happens? I go into Nirvikalpa Samadhi. Is this the goal that we are seeking? So what I have done? All I have done is, by mistake, I fell into Nirvikalpa Samadhi. By mistake. Because this condition can happen at a time of shock. It can happen at a time of shock. It can happen as a when a person is coma, everything is deleted. Is he in Samadhi? Yes and no. But does he know himself? No. So which knowing yourself we are talking about? This is the question. Where are we? Huh? Because our goal is that once we come to abide in the self, once I get into Samadhi, I want to be transformed in such a way that when I come out of Samadhi, when the mind comes out of Samadhi, not I, when the mind comes out of Samadhi, because Samadhi is not for the self, Samadhi is for the mind. When the mind comes out of the Samadhi, like mind comes out of sleep, it becomes awake. So when mind comes out of Samadhi, out of absorption, it does not see the world. We want that stage. Then what does it see? It sees only I. I'll tell you, give you an example here. Are you looking at your hands, fingers, upper arm, stomach, chest, legs, knees, ankles, back, head, senses. Are you seeing them right now? Do you know they are there? Are you all the time thinking? Or without thinking, you feel you are pervading the whole body? Do you think this body is other than you? Or do you think this is me? This is me, isn't it? Imagine. Sahaja state is that even if he comes out, wherever his senses are, mind is, everything is without a thought. It is me, 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 me. I. This is his experience. I have already answered, but we have to go to the next question. Huh? So question is, in the fifth question, the question remains that what happens to the desires which were pre-existing in the mind, which were not fulfilled? He chose one desire. Out of the thousands and millions of desires in the mind, he chose one. I want to be in samadhi. I want to realize. And he realizes. What happened to the other desires which are still remaining unfulfilled? What will happen to them?
Come
back. Huh?
Come back.
For the ignorant, they will come back. If you are in nirvikalpa samadhi, they will come back. We are talking from the person who has come to realize. So he has not gone into jada samadhi. His nirvikalpa samadhi is the jada samadhi. Why? Nirvikalpa samadhi is because only you deleted the world and you find yourself in samadhi. We are talking about abidance in the self. And once you are widened in the self, what about those unfinished desires? Suppose before going to samadhi or coming to realize, you wanted to build an ashram, you wanted to build a temple, you wanted to see your children get married, or you had a bucket list which you had to complete, and suddenly you realize. Now what will happen? What will happen to that bucket list? How can it become absolute? That is, okay, let's see. She says it becomes absolute. That's what he said, yes?
If he is completely absorbed in himself, he wouldn't be concentrating on his other desires which have also.
That is your journey from outward to inside. Now you have realized, you have established. But don't you see realized masters having a mind? They are talking, they are feeling, they are hungry, they are thirsty. They are, isn't it? The mind is still there. So what has happened to those all other desires? Leave the question, understand the question. Important is to understand the question and then we look at the answers. Then the sixth question now. We did this kalpate. Sixth question. Kamena yogam abhyasya, kamena yogam abhyasya, sthita prajnyo bhaved yadi, sthita prajnyo bhaved yadi, sakamo mushya safalyam, sakamo mushya safalyam, adigachati vanava, adigachati vanava. In the sixth question he asks, yes, if one practicing yoga for a desired end becomes a sthita prajna, becomes established in the self, is that desire also fulfilled or not? In other words, if one practicing yoga for fulfilling a desire becomes becomes established in the self, will there be desire be fulfilled or not? Again, this is a different question a little bit, and that is, the scriptures say that when you abide in the self, all desires are destroyed, right? When you abide in the self, when you realize, when you get enlightened, all desires are burned away. This is what the scriptures say. If that is the question, then the question is, what will be the destiny of the desires which are remaining? What will happen to the desire of seeking liberation? What will happen to that desire? Will it become fulfilled or not? Or will it also remain unfulfilled? Others have got burnt, but this one desire was active, that I want to realize. Will it get fulfilled or not get fulfilled? Will it get satisfied or not get satisfied? And we began, we have come here to study this text. It is our desire which has brought us here, isn't it? Is it like we have we'll have a desire to eat food. We'll eat food. Will the hunger get satisfied? But then in the evening again you will get hungry. Again you will get hungry. So he is asking that this desire, is it like other desires? That I will get fulfilled now, and then again afterwards, again the desire for fulfillment will be there, to realize will be there. Is it going to be a permanent fulfillment of the desire, or is it like other desires, like I keep getting hungry for food? Again it will come up and demand the sadhana. Do I have to continue to do something in order to be established in the self? Do I need to continue doing something in order to be established in the self? Or will it be satiated once and for all?
Or can I be established in the self, wanting to be established in the self?
That's another way of putting it. Can I be established in the self without or with?
With the desire.
With the desire to be established in the self. Good. So is that desire valid? Or is abidance in the self?
Desires.
Correct. Thank you. He's with it. Or is the establishment in the self, abidance in the self, being the self, all meaning the same, being the self is beyond desire? And if it is beyond desire, what will happen to that desire? These are, yes? You ask something?
No.
No, okay. So these are the six questions. Hearing these, we'll look at one more verse and we'll stop. Hearing these questions, the two verses are there. Evam mama guru prashnan. Evam mama guru prashnan. अकर्ण्य करुणानिधि अकर्ण्य करुणानिधि अब्रवीत संशयच्छेदी अब्रवीत संशयच्छेदी रमणो भगवान ऋषि रमणो भगवान ऋषि. हियरिंग दीज क्वेश्चंस ऑफ माइन भगवान श्री रमणा ऋषि टू डिस्पेल माय डाउट्स एंड इन द प्लेनिट्यूड ऑफ हिज ग्रेस स्पोक इन दिस मैनर. Now the answers will be given. These are the type of questions we must ask Guru Maharaj. Who is the ultimate Guru?
Self.
So what is the dialogue that you should be having with yourself in the mind all the time? What should I cook for tonight? What am I going to do after class? Oh my God, Swamiji said he will finish at 3:30. It's already 4:45. And we are talking about self-realization here. And you are worried about you have to leave at 4 o'clock. And I'm not, Swamiji is not finishing. And for the eyes, Swamiji. Nobody has done it. I'm just making story. But watch, at this moment, is your mind with yourself or is it distracted? So with this type of, so ultimate guru is, see in Sri Ramana Paravidya Upanishad, their second verse, Ishvara Guru Ratmeti. So there three steps are given, Ishvara, Guru and Atma. So there Ramana Maharishi says, always first remember the Lord. All these fellows. Personal God. When you remember Him, when you surrender to Him, when you feel, when you have the love for Him, He will send the Guru into your life. You don't choose Guru. That this person, I think, oh, he was so fantastic. I think he is my Guru. Oh, he manifested a thing and gave it to me. I think he is my Guru. Oh, he could read my past and future. I think he is my Guru. No. You student or a devotee, student here, student must never decide who your Guru is. Then what you should do? Only remember the Lord Divine. And that Lord, when your urge has matured to a certain extent and you are seeking answers, why am I not, I'm thinking of you so much and still I'm not being one with you, where am I going wrong, where am I going wrong, what is lacking in me, what I need to understand more, the teacher will come into your life automatically. How, where, when, it's not your concern. He sends because He is everywhere. You are somewhere. He is everywhere. And He manifests. He is manifesting everywhere, isn't it? In through you, also through you. But He will send the right teacher. Not up necessarily with a beard. He could be a married lady. It could be a child. It could be a whichever way. If you are committed to the divine, you will recognize that He is the teacher. Why? And you will not just go blindly, you will ask questions, you will test the teacher out, and eventually you will come to say, yeah, I can learn something here. And what does teacher teach? Not how to realize. What does teacher teach? What does the Guru Maharaj teach?
Abiding the self.
Abiding in the self is one way. Unraveling yourself. The Guru Maharaj teaches that you don't have to go after God. You don't have to go after the Guru. You have to discover the Guru as the self. See? That is the journey. But if you do it as an ego trip, that I have come to know myself, gone. It must happen effortlessly. By remembering Him who brings teacher in our life and interact. But what happens to us? We get attached to the teacher. We get attached to the Mahatmas. Isn't it? Did Ramana Maharishi have any guru? Did he have any guru? No. Did he study any scriptures? No. Then what did he do? He just had a death experience. And he realized that he is not the body. And the question came to his mind, then who am I? And that one question was the trailblazer. And it made him give up everything. And so from childhood he had this vision of Arunachala in his mind. God's grace. And he went there. And Arunachala, an inert mountain, became his guru. And he sat in his lap in the cave and meditated and realized that the self is the guru. The self is of the nature of everything. See? This is our journey. So, wherever we are, whatever we are, in whatever conditions we are, in whatever emotional makeup we are, never forget you are beyond whatever you are experiencing. Always. Keep a one-arm distance to all that, initially, initial stages. So what Ramana Maharishi is going to answer to these questions, we will see in our next class. And he is going to give from his direct experience. He is not going to talk from scriptures. Each answer to each question will be unique, and we'll unfold that as we go along. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om. Just sit quietly for a minute or two.